All right, welcome back. Welcome back for this third day of lightning. Hooray. Better than the second day and better than the first day, even though the first day was amazing and the second day was double amazing, this will be triple amazing. So, what was I going to say? A couple of little announcements. If you see anyone walking around with a badge like this, a green badge, these badges are beginner mentors badge. So let's say the person wearing this badge is happy to answer any questions you have. If you're a beginner, and that doesn't mean a beginner at programming, in any topic, but you have a question, and that person will automatically be an expert in that subject and reply magically to you. No, I mean, that person is there to help with any questions you have. Questions about the conference, questions about what talks to try out next, question about who to talk to or where to find out more information about something, whatever it is. People wearing these badges are specifically very happy for any questions. Interrupt them halfway through a conversation, whatever it is. It's our job as beginner Montfils to... Yep, what's the question? I'm here to help. Sorry? Okay, so there's some bathrooms if you come out immediately on the left and also a little bit further back on the right. You're welcome. All right, so that's the mentor's badge. The other thing I wanted to introduce is, I'm going to say Fabian here, who is talking about the mouse icebreaker. So you may as well remember the story about having an icebreaker game that's going to encourage people to just talk to each other and say hi to strangers. So Fabian has come up with some cool rules and a cool game. The explanation is outside by the door, but a quick explanation in person, I think, will help to really make it concrete. I've already started on the game. It's going great.
Okay, hello. So after the lightning talk yesterday evening, there were quite a lot of people that were interested to help and do something. And we figured out some, well, let's call it the first iteration of a game. It's just that our PR department completely failed. So there is a board somewhere here directly. If you're coming out of the room, then you'll see a board, and there are the game rules. But I think hardly anybody realized that. Maybe with a show of hand, who realized that the game is already going on? Okay, but well, now everybody of you knows it. Directly there are the rules, and we'll continue tomorrow. And the thing is that unfortunately, three viruses have spread through all participants. And in order to, well, the objective of the game is to disable those viruses on your own software, on your own operating system, and you need for each one a code. One code is very easy to obtain because it's a static code. It's just one certain code, and as soon as most people know it, it's very easy. You just ask, do you have the code? And at some point, everybody knows it. The other two codes are a bit more difficult because they are personal codes. They change, and we have a really, really electronic gadget. Well, it's actually a piece of paper, but we call them, what do we call them?
Emitters.
They are code emitters, those pieces of paper. And there are some emitters that are moving around. So as soon as you go around and ask, hey, do you have an emitter? And if that person has an emitter, then you will have that from then on. And so you have to just go around and ask. And the third one also is with an emitter, but the emitter stays with the person. And those are the persons that have, I don't have my badge on, that have a little mouse, a hand-drawn mouse on the badge. Those are the game admins. They also know all the rules, and they have another emitter. And if you have all three of them, I will ask tomorrow in the lightning talks who has the most codes. So, play the game.
All right, so our first speaker is Julian Tebolt, and for setting up and getting ready before that, I'd like Philip Chebchik. Okay. Philip, where are you? Wait. Okay. Fantastic. All right. So, is there anything that's on your mind, everyone? What? How do we get a badge?
How do we get one of the green badges if we want to help
you? Oh, yeah. So if you'd like to be a beginner mentor, we have an oath that you have to take. So there's a little bit of training, you know, you have to swear to do certain things and promise. I based it on the Oath of the Night's Watch from Game of Thrones. So if you just come and see me afterwards, I'll explain the oath, and if you're prepared to take it on, it's a big responsibility. It means that you have to be prepared to, like, stop trying to impress your friends with your incredibly geeky knowledge of technology that you've learned this year, and instead just go, oh, sorry, okay, fine, I'm answering your question about beginner issues from now on and for the next hour if necessary. So it's a big responsibility, but we do need help. So come and see me afterwards, and I will definitely give you a badge if you swear the oath. On that note, are you ready, sir?
Yeah.
Julian, take it away.
Okay. At first, sorry for my accent and my mistake. I'm French, so I will try to do my best in English. My talk is about MongoDB as a Tostada. I want to compare MongoDB database with a Tostada. Tostada is a huge, huge cake. Last night, it was a nightmare to finish it. Even more, after it, so many tapas. MongoDB is also a nightmare when using or missing indexes. I know people say MongoDB is slow, it's not ACID, the query language sucks, but I love it.
Six people.
Okay. The Tostada, as you can see, is very, very fat. To prevent MongoDB from becoming a Tostada, you must monitor the slow operation. So how to locate and trigger an action on long-running operation. You can use the profiler or the command current OP, but it's impossible to trigger a specific action. Let's go. So we have a simple live demo. I will try to simulate a slow operation. Okay, sorry. So, as you can see, I'm trying to find a bottleneck, which is a Tostada. We can retrieve some information about the current operation with current OP, but you need to wait the end of the operation. As you can see, it's very, very, very long. So, I wrote simple tools, is a mongoop. You can send a different trigger. You have a killer trigger. It tries to terminate a long operation, and you have the MongoDB trigger. It's a simple insert on another database. Yes, okay. I run mongoop, okay. And I try to simulate the same operation. You can see. The first action is trigger, and the other is trigger. And now the operation was interrupted. It's on GitHub. The project is not mature, not enough to be in production. I need more tests, more triggers, like Sentry, ERC, INACA for your monitoring tools. Maybe Python 3, but I'm a little confused with that. And I need your feedback and your help. To finish, if you want to try to eat the Tostada, I know the restaurant.
Okay, Philip coming up. And then after Philip, we've got Daniel Mild on Pi Benchmarks. Good. All right, anything else on your mind, everyone? Yeah, yeah. What's that? The what? I kind of forgot what the beginning of the story was. I don't know if I can actually. Yeah, exactly. I don't know if I can remember the whole thing unless I start at the beginning. So maybe we'll do that. Like, what was it? It was about a man who really likes tractors. Isn't that right? So, where were we at the end of it? Do you anyone? Where were we in the story? Who remembers? So he was. Everything was on fire. He was burning all the old tractors, and the old tractor posters. But I guess maybe. Now that you've reminded me, we can have the rest of the story a little bit later. So, take it away, Philip.
Hi, I'm Philip. I'm the main organizer of PyCon PL.
I'll go and clap him. Yeah, come on.
And I would like to talk about PyCon PL. So I kind of made a bit of research and to see how are PyCons in Central Eastern Europe doing. I've noticed that PyCon PL is the oldest one, but new PyCons are appearing. I would like to encourage you to try to attend proposed talks for those PyCons. This year, there were many new PyCons in the Central Eastern Europe, for example, PyCon Belarus, PyCon Lithuania, and there will be PyCon Czech in November 2015, and the next year there will be a first PyCon Slovakia. But I will talk about the PyCon PL. So, our PyCon is a bit different than other national PyCons, in the sense that we are not picking big cities, you know? Probably the name of the cities or town or villages that we are organizing the conference are totally unknown to you. So that was kind of our idea. So we are kind of booking one hotel, and all attendees are staying in that hotel, almost, because people that are living nearby probably want to stay at homes. And that way, our PyCons take place in completely different areas, usually close to the nature, so mountains, forests. And I think that's kind of pretty cool. And what are the advantages for attendees? So you don't have to worry about reaching back to your hotel at social event, because you are everything happens in the same place. You don't have to worry about the weather, about unexpected rains. So everything is close, hotel room, conference room, bar. If you forget something, you can easily come back to your room and take it. If you are kind of tired and need to rest from everyone, you can go hiking. And this kind of approach also gives us opportunity to superb socializing. And now about the current edition. It will happen in the mid-October in a village called Ossa. We'll have six tracks. There will be two English tracks, two Polish tracks, and two workshop tracks mixed. Some of them will be in English and Polish. We are expecting 600 to 700 attendees. Last year we had 500 attendees. So we are kind of growing every year. Full ticket includes hotel room. It's a four-star hotel and meals during the conference. So regarding the speakers, as you see, we have speakers from different countries on PyCon PL, and I think that's very good. We'll also have a PyLadies workshop from test-driven development. I must admit that the kind of diversity problems are also applying to us in Poland, and we need more women speakers. On this edition, we'll have 5 women speaking, but even though the call for proposals is closed, you can still submit a proposal. We'll try to find a place in the agenda. So where exactly is PyCon PL 2015? So it's in a village, as you see. It's 1 hour from Warsaw, so this is important. This is the view from the OpenStreetMap. Actually, a month ago, there was nothing on OpenStreetMap there, but thanks to the OpenStreetMap community, we have the hotel complex mapped. That's how the place looks like. You know, because it's in the middle of nowhere, then kind of bus transfers are important, and there will be special buses organized by us that will go to the hotel. There will be many activities during the conference. Follow the White Python Coding Challenge. Every night there will be board and card games. There will be a grill and barbecue party on Saturday. Every night there's a party going on the dance floor. And if you want to come with your kids, there's a special program for them. so you can enjoy the conference while your kids are under good care. That's the view of the auditorium. There is a free swimming pool, jacuzzi, and sauna for all the attendees. Yeah. So these are the prices, and I think these are actually really cheap if you compare with other conferences. So for a ticket, you can buy for 190 euros, and it includes accommodation in the hotel plus meals. That's how the hotel rooms look like. If you think that's too much, you can apply for a financial aid at our website. These are the comments, and I think that comments of our attendees say a lot about the conference. It's worth to attend. So have a look. The last comment is, you know, still waiting for my ears to stop ringing after three nights of disco at PyCompiel. We have different games during the evenings. Different groups are meeting. Yeah, kind of, I'm going fast. And in Poland, we don't eat sandwiches on lunch.
Amazing. So after Daniel, can we have Rob Collins? Are you near the front? There you go, that's good enough. And after Rob, it'll be Philip Fritzi. Are you here somewhere, Philip? Fritzi? Yeah, close enough to the front to be able to run in? Okay. All right, fantastic. So our guy who's just gone crazy with his tractor, he's gone too far. He's decided to just quit. He's piled up all his tractor memorabilia, all his pictures of tractors, all his old tractors. He's put them in a massive bonfire in his garden, and he's going to set fire to it. And he's just watching it all burn away, and he's like, that's the end of my old life. No more tractors. I'm finished with it. And he's sort of sad, but he's also like, this is a big milestone for him. And he feels like ready to move on. You know, ready to put it behind him. Are you ready?
Not yet.
Okay, so he's ready to put it behind him. And you know, he like, after this is done, after it's all gone, he just goes, ah, that's better. I feel better. I think I'm gonna go for a drink. So he goes down to the pub, he walks across to his village pub, and he walks in and the pub is kind of empty. And there's not many people around. And I think the reason he smells this weird smell, and he goes, I think the reason this pub is empty is because there's a really bad smell in here. And he goes up to the barman and he goes, hey, like, what's going on with the smell? And the barman goes, oh, I don't know. It's been like that for days. Still waiting? Oh, that's loading, is it? Okay. Look at that. Take it away.
Okay, so, hi, everyone. How many of you know the computer language benchmark game? Okay, so, as you may know, it's a great website where you can compare the performance of different programming languages. But there is only one Python interpreter available. So, and we want more because we have many interpreters. So, fortunately, the project is open source. So I created a fork. It's called pybenchmarks.org. You can see it here. It looks the same as the original project. So now you can compare, for example, JSON, but wait, no, you don't want that. So once again, you can compare, for example, PyPy 3 to Cython, or you can have a look how the new Python 3.5 is doing, or compare another nice compilers and interpreters. So, pybenchmark.org. The benchmarks are not perfect yet, of course. So, if you want to participate, there is a link to source code. It's on GitHub. So, please feel free to send a pull request. That's all. Thank you.
All right, Rob, you're up next, and Philip is after that. Okay, so he's gone to the pub, and there's a weird smell, and he's like, what's that weird smell? And the barman goes, I don't know, it's just been It's been like that for days. And the guy goes, you know what? I think I can help you with this. And he walks to one in the pub for a little bit, and he's trying to smell the place where the smell is strongest. And he eventually stops it, and he goes, all right, I think it's here. And he goes like this. And then he walks out to the door of the pub, and he goes out the door of the pub, and he goes outside. And he walks back in, and he goes, and he walks back outside. Are you waiting to talk?
Oh. I'm waiting for Windows. Sorry, guys. It's not my...
No, that's all right. We've got about 15 minutes of this joke left. So...
Have a good time.
He goes back into the middle, walks back outside, and slowly, the smell is disappearing, and the barman's like, this is crazy. And he goes, walks out a few more times. Like that. And until he does this several more times over the course of sort of a few minutes until the smell is completely gone. And the barman goes, that's amazing. I've never seen anything like that. What happened? Like, how did you do that? And the guy goes, well, you see, I'm an ex-tractor fan. There you go.
Now we wait for Mozilla.
Okay, not bad, huh? I know several more stories in that sort of vein. There's one about a paint program in the 90s and a Chinese conspiracy theory. But that like very much relies on people having a decent knowledge of like early 90s desktop software. If you have a good knowledge of early 90s like paint software, hand up, put your hands up. Okay, so that's like 35%. So should I waste like everyone's time for a joke that's only gonna hit 35%? I think so. No. Philip, take it away.
So, thank you. My name is Philip and I am DevOps and paramedic. In my world, there is a new revolution, containers. Containers at most everywhere. There is a few applications to run new containers, like RunC, Docker, Rocket, Vag, LXC, and so more. But there is no one application in Python, right? But there is a Python conference, so I create a package, PySpaces. It's try to implement some containers, Linux containers feature, like namespaces, cgroups, and so other. There is a lot of work should be done before it's ready for production. But I hope you enjoy this package, and help me to create great application for containers for development and deployment. By the way, I'm a member of the Belarusian Python meetup, and you can find our community at Facebook and at Twitter. So enjoy us, and we should take a part and create together new big challenge, new world with Python. Thank you.
Fantastic. I had a good one. Yeah, so we're probably not going to do the early 90s paid program. I have another joke, if you like, that's like really highly dependent on people knowing the meanings of two words. So like, would you put your hands up if you know the meaning of the word apposite, A-P-P-O-S-I-T-E. Yep, and the word pachyderm, P-A-C-H-Y-D-E-R-M. All right, now if you knew both of those together. All right, you guys, what do you call an apposite pachyderm? A relevant. Okay, because apposite means relevant, and a pachyderm is elephants and rhinoceroses. Yeah, pretty good. I was pleased with it, yeah. What do you think, like the jokes I make up versus the jokes that are real jokes, how do they compare? Yeah. What do you think, like extractor fan versus Tina Turner, which did you prefer out of this? Like hands up for extractor fan? All right, hands up for Tina Turner? Yeah, guess which one I made up? What? Say what? That's pretty much what I'm doing. Like, how do you make up a joke? Well, the Tina Turner one, right, you can pretty much tell. I made that up in the shower, because obviously I was singing. And then I thought, secondhand emotion, secondhand in motion. That's it. And you just work backwards from there, just figure out a long story where, like, somehow there's going to be a reason for someone to say that. And you're there. You've got a joke. It's amazing. How are you getting on over there, Rob?
Okay.
Yep. All right. We'll take some time. All right. How about a joke that's like...
No, I'm okay.
Oh, you're ready to go?
Yes. My pitch is not scaling, but I think that's the point. So first of all, I'd like to say thank you for those who participated in the sponsored massage. So hands up, who's had a massage so far? What was it? Was it good? Yeah. Well. It's not too late. We have one more session tomorrow at lunchtime for you to get a massage and to give money to the Python Software Foundation. So we had 16 people doing the training on Tuesday, and they made a good team, and spreading out, talking to lots of people and giving massages, we've raised over €1,000 for the Python Software Foundation so far. Now, there is a problem. Great team, but we haven't covered everyone at this conference, and there's a bus factor of one that it depends on me being here and doesn't scale even in this conference, let alone other conferences. So I thought, what about we try and write things down, help other conferences be able to do the same thing. Other Python conferences could raise money for the Python Software Foundation. Could scale to other programming languages and other good causes. So I need to delegate, because it isn't that difficult to do, but it's not trivial. So there are some things, and we were thinking, well, supposing we had a website to help groups be able to organize a sponsored massage so that other people could do it. Now, show of hands, do you think that would be a good idea to do that? And anyone not asking for help, just sort of your opinion of whether you think it might be or not. Right? Yes, well, no, I'm not asking for more donations. I'm asking for some help. So I'd like you to think about how you could help, not just for massaging, but for organizing, designing, writing things. So this isn't going to scale properly here, but if I can get this there. So the PythonMassageFoundation.org, go to the website. The only thing it does is to allow you to subscribe, put your email address in there, and we can build something that would be actually useful for other groups to be able to do the same thing with more teams of people and raise more money for good causes. Please go there and talk to me afterwards. Thank you.
All right, Patrick Goodry on PyTest and Selenium. And after that, we've got Alof Bradbury.
Alex Bradbury.
Yeah. Alof is a good name too, though, right? Yeah, yeah. Okay, that's someone I actually know, everyone? Yeah, Alex Bradbury, yes, fine, okay. Are you close enough to be able to run up and give the talk? Would you like to move to the front row, maybe disrupt now rather than later? Jolly good. Yeah, so come on, let's, rather than having another really tedious joke, you know, we all talk about community a lot in Python, and that's not a word that meant a lot to me for my first few years in the Python community. And I was like, well, I don't know, you know, I'm British, and I don't like to talk about my feelings or express them or really admit that they're of any use. So community sounded a bit wishy-washy to me. And I think the first time I really got it, I was in a Django con, and the setup was that they were going to announce Django migrations, which was made by a man called Andrew Godwin. Are you here, Andrew? Andrew? Someone called Andrew put their hand up. And he was going to announce that the Django migrations is merged into Django Core from being a separate project called South. And I'll finish the rest of the story after this talk. So Patrick, take it away.
Hi, everyone. As previously stated, my name is Patrick Cudré, and I work for Numberly. We had a lot of nice talks about tests and test-driven development, mainly for command line tools. I'm a bit lazier than that, and I had to test pages, HTML pages with links and whatnot. So here is to just take tests in that direction just a bit, so you don't have to manually click on everything. So first, I use PyTest for my tests because it allows me to build either unit testing or functional tests. It supports what it calls fixtures, which are a nice way to prepare your environment. Well, depending on what you run, it can be either fast or not. Well, if you sleep 10, it will be slower than expected. And it has nice reports, as you can see right here. That's the kind of report you get with the number of tests failed, number of tests passed, and you know which one failed and what it failed on. For those that might not know what Selenium is, it's kind of like enabling a ghost possession of your computer. You program your Python script, and it just goes opening stuff and manipulating your brother. Well, your brothers, actually, as it supports more than one. And what we are going to do is trying to use them both together. That way, all the tests you had to do are going to be done automatically, and you can go sword fighting on chairs. Okay, so I have a very lightweight Flask app that runs mostly nothing. It has one simple input that puts the text in the page and one link that just redirects to another page with another link. So running Selenium is just going to open the browser and do stuff, but as you can see, I have no idea what has been going on. So running PyTest, I can see that he has four tests to run. Ran the first one correctly, the second one failed, third one passed, fourth one passed. And now I can see that, actually, yes, the second one failed, and I know why. The actual code for the PyTest tests is really lightweight. The only thing is to define your fixture. You just instantiate your brother, yield it so you can use it, and quit it just when your test is done. And that's it. You got here the PyTest website, Selenium website. Be aware that Selenium is not strictly Python. It is also available in other languages. That URL is to access the presentation as it's available, and that's the whole code for this lightning talk, including the very lightweight Flask app. Thank you.
All right, after Alex, we've got Tom Bollinger. Are you around, Tom?
Here.
Hooray. Okay, so South, the migrations framework for Django, who's used that? And who's used Django migrations? All right, so there was a guy called Justin who you might come across if you go to a lot of Python conferences, who's a lovely guy. And he's going to be, hey, Harry, and like, it took someone American really to kind of explain this community thing to me, because the Americans, unlike the British, aren't afraid of talking about their feelings, Justin in particular. And so he said to me, hey, Harry, man, are you going to Andrew's talk? I went, ah, no, can't be bothered. South is already really good. I know that Django migrations just slightly improves it, but it's more or less the same. The only thing I want to hear from that talk is like, hey, Andrew, is it more or less the same? Yes. Did you do a good job? Yes. Will it all be obvious? Yes. Thanks very much. Goodbye. So that's not a talk I want to go to.
And Justin says to me, man, that's not the point. The point is, this is Andrew's big day, man. Like, he made this tool south that we all use all the time. And like, it makes our lives so much easier, man. And like, we love it so much. And like, he's finally come into the Django core, man. Like, his project is recognized. It's a part of it. And we've just got to be there, man. We got to be there for his big day, man, to just be there and be present. And like, say thank you, man. Like, we are grateful. We are grateful to you, and we are here for you, man. And I didn't actually end up going to the talk, but I was almost ready for that lesson, but not quite. But you know, that's the sort of thing. So that's the sort of thing. Alex, take it away.
Thanks. Hi. So I'm.
I'm not doing my crap good enough while I try and set this up.
Hi, so I'm Alex. I'm a researcher at University of Cambridge, and for a number of years I've been working with interns over summer working on Raspberry Pi related projects. And so this project, PiLand, is something that a bunch worked on last year and have continued this year, and I thought I'd tell you a little bit about it and how you can help us out in our aims. So PiLand aims to be a game which helps to teach children to learn to program using Python. So to take a little step back and kind of motivate this a little, some of you may have seen this before. This is called MIT Scratch. So this is how a lot of children may start out learning programming. It's really nice, it's visual, it's easy. You drag and drop, you can draw your little fish, and you can easily add behavior to them. And that's great. And so children at kind of end of primary school, maybe 7 years old, 8 years old, might start playing with this. But then we want to move on to something new, so you move on to Python. And then to get to where you were with Python where you could have all this, you know, interactivity, moving images, making your own games, actually takes rather a lot of time, which can often be rather off-putting. I mean, this is a kind of translation of what was probably the first kind of program that I wrote. So on my Amiga 500, I only had a BBC Basic book, so I was very frustrated that not everything quite worked properly in Amiga Basic. But I was very excited when I had a knock-knock joke thing. I went to show my mum, and I thought this was fantastic. But one thing I've learned in life is that not everybody's like me. In fact, quite a lot of people aren't like me. And for many people, just something simple and textual, which prints something out on a screen, in a world where you have, your mobile phone can do amazing things, you go home, you play your PlayStation, your Xbox, that's not all that compelling. Although for many people, it does give a good sense of achievement. And so what we're trying to do with PiLand is producing something which is graphical, it's intuitive, it's attractive to children, so that you can write Python and get something which is but you're kind of motivated to write it to, move on to solve puzzles in this game. And here is obviously, integrated editor isn't quite finished, so it's a little bit of a mock-up, but this is all showing the graphics that we had made for us last year. And obviously this student here is about to be told off very badly for not obeying PEP 8, but I'm now going to be slightly risky and give you a demo of what it looks like currently. So if I hold M, there we go. Yeah, so this is our little guy, Ben. He's our main character. On level screen, I can move to a level here, say, where we've got our crocodiles moseying about. So each character has a Python script associated with it, which you can use to control their behavior. And of course, I'm just using my arrow keys here. Unlike some programming games, we don't try and we don't want to force people to program in cases where it's not actually helpful. That's only going to put them off, whereas you have to open a text editor just to move left or right. So this is a simple level where we have another character, Milo, who's our little monkey friend, who is going to help us out. I know, Milo is definitely my favorite character. I just love the way that the animations come out there. so that's kind of... So we've been working on this last year. We've got a bunch of, a team of three interns working with me this year to try and get it towards something that's releasable that we can share more widely. So the aim, as I said, is children, kind of ages 10 plus. We're kind of practicing, as I said, intern-driven development, where it's very much limited by manpower there. So the game engine itself is written in C++ and is increasingly Python scriptable. I should point out that one of the key requirements is that it has to run on the original Raspberry Pi, so the 700 megahertz rather weedy ARM, which limits your options somewhat. So that's which is very difficult because quite a lot of schools already have these. And of course, it's all fully open sourced. And so our aims, the things we're working on this summer, so we've had a few weeks with the amazing set of interns who've already, they've come up with this kind of story about having, you're on this island and there's a group of people who can both write and run programs, there's another group of people who can only run programs, and you have to help the people who can only run them, which it sounds like it could be very, very political, but that's not totally the aim. And so our key aims this summer have been working on more content, making it so it's easily extensible so that you can write levels in Python so that you might have a teacher who modifies or customizes them, or indeed children might be able to write their own levels and share them with their friends, and working on this integrated text editor, whereas currently you have to kind of switch to a separate window. And so if you want to get involved or look at what's currently there, go to pyland.org, follow us on Twitter, talk to me afterwards, and also thanks to Raspberry Pi Foundation and the Broadcom Foundation for funding this, and a big thanks to all my interns this year and last year who have done all the actual work. Thanks very much.
Tom, you're up next. Okay, guys, so like it's 6 o'clock, so Tom should be the last talk. Would anyone like to stay around for longer? Like by applause, stay for longer. Versus by applause, go home, go to bed, go and have food, go to sleep, like, and just generally relax. All right. So that has it. So I'm going to propose that we stay for another 20 minutes or so. Anybody that like is actually knackered at this point, this is a good time to leave while I'm talking because that's just a waste of time. Whereas while Tom's talking, that's going to be interesting, entertaining, intelligent, fascinating, warm, loving, community-based, and all sorts of things like that. Are you ready, Tom?
Every one of those things. Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
All set.
Yeah. Are you sure? Yep. Give Tom a big hand.
Great.
Well. Great.
All right, I want to tell you about something that it's almost generous to call a hack. It's somewhere between a hack and a joke. But this is RL undo. It's undo in any interactive interpreter with an asterisk there, we'll explain later. So I work on a project called BPython, which is pretty fun. It's got undo, as you can see here. We hit a button, and then we undo the state. And then A isn't even defined anymore. So we've undone the state here. We're taking the entire state of the program, kind of rewriting what we want it to be. And just from this little brief thing of what you've seen so far, imagine for a few seconds how might you implement something like this. The undo part here is what I mean, where we can go back and then that variable isn't defined anymore. We've undone that thing. So think about it for a second or two. Oh, it's a pretty dumb way what we're doing. What we are doing is, I have to explain it first. What we're doing is just replaying the state. So we just remember all the commands that you ran, and when you undo, we just redo all of them except the most recent one. And then when you undo again, it does again. So this works pretty well when you're trying out the syntax of something, but if you're trying to do real work and do something that takes 10 seconds, it's gonna take 10 seconds to rewind your most recent thing. So useful, neat, but limited. So where does this fail? It takes time to rebuild that state. While you're rebuilding that state, you might use non-deterministic operations. We don't reseed random or anything like that, and maybe you're doing non-edempotent stuff. You're appending bytes to a file, so that happens each time you undo. File system changes, we're not going to have a whole VM and then rewind those file changes, and we're certainly not going to like simulate the universe and like recall those bytes from Google that fired the missiles or whatever. So that's kind of out of scope, but we could move down a little bit. We could accomplish some of these first ones, and the way we could do that is by saving snapshots of states instead. What if instead of rebuilding the prior state each time, instead we save these snapshots and just return to them? Obviously, this would have higher memory requirements, it seems like, but we get around the rebuilding time. We get around running things twice and their side effects happening twice. Right, those higher memory requirements, probably a problem. Let's try to do this copy on write thing. Functional programmers talk about this a lot. They're like, ooh, in Clojure, we have these data structures that are immutable, and we can do this clever kind of, when we make a copy, it actually refers to these things, but you have to kind of, and we could do some immutable stuff in Python, but I think it's not real general enough. What we're gonna do instead is fork. So on Unix, we have this way of copying our process and making another one that looks just like it, and it's doing this copy on write stuff
at the operating system level. So that's pretty cool. We could use that to save these states. Let's try to do that. Every time something interesting happens, we'll just fork. Okay. So this is a hack in three parts. First off, we're going to use readline. Readline is a program a lot of interactive interpreters use. It's inside the program, right? So that's the same process, and we could fork it to save these. When we can intercept what the user types, and if they type undo, we can just die, and the previous one will take over, because it's just sitting there waiting. And we have to get readline into these things somehow, so we're going to intercept the dynamic library call. And then we have to rewrite the terminal a little bit. So let's take a look at this. Here's it is with Python. I can say, looks like B is there, but if we do this, B's not there anymore. So this is with saving snapshots. But this is with forking, and lots of things use readline. So say that we have, for some reason, we have to use this other programming language called Ruby here, and or Racket, or Lua, or a lot of other things that also use readline. Here's A. But then we do this, and it's not there anymore. And we can see if we were to, we can see the process tree here, 3, 4, 9, 8. We can watch this get bigger. So maybe not ideal, but it's copy on write. It's probably great. And we can undo. It looks like we've got off a little bit. So rewriting the terminal isn't quite working correctly. So this is a fun thing. That's it. That's cool.
Don't go away. Oh, I was just clapping the achievement.
That's all. I'll have updates. So it's a joke, right? Is it good? No, it's not a good idea. Redo too. That would be cool. We could save them. You could jump around. So we don't have any of that stuff. But we do. I have tests for this where we're starting to. It could almost maybe kind of work. So if you want to contribute to it, it's at github.com, Thomas Ballinger, all undo. And that's it.
I want one that just guesses what I was about to do next and skips into the future. That would be even better. Yeah, fine. So what was I talking about with the Andrew story there really is that, you know, like the value of going to a talk is not necessarily like the information that you can get out of it and what you can sort of selfishly get out of the conference. Some of it is also about recognizing people. Yes. So it's me next. That's the important part about this whole thing. So next we've got Niklas Olofsson. And after that, we've got Jerky Polainen. Sorry, Jerky. Niklas, are you nearby? Hooray! Yeah. So sometimes you just go to talks because you've got to support someone, you know? And that's nice, too. And it's all important, this community stuff, because we, like, donate our time, isn't it? Like, open source software, free software. It's all based on the work of volunteers. And so, you know, you need to get some sort of payback for that. And that payback is going to be nice things like your friends showing up to your talk or people recognizing the hard work that you've put in by just being there and clapping for you, even if they've got no good reason selfishly to be there. Are you ready, Niklas?
Yes. Yeah.
So take it away.
So my name is Niklas, and this is basically my first talk ever, so please bear with me. I'm going to talk about efficient allocation of space, and the challenge of this is basically to, you have a number of elements, and you want to store them in some data structure with some constraints. So, for example, if you have this squirrel who wants to manage his acorns in some way, we can use a box with slots. You can store like one acorn in each of the slots. So this is basically an array. But you can only fill these boxes from the sides. And the tricky thing is that the acorns block each other. So if you add like two acorns like this, you can't really add any more acorns. So in this case, we are only storing two acorns, but we have seven slots, so we get really crappy performance or efficiency in that case. We can also have like a matrix with multiple boxes, but it's the same like restrictions. You can only fill them from the sides. So how do we fill these efficiently? Well, we could like add one acorn, and then we can add a little bit of space and a little bit just because, you know, there is quite much space, so we can just add little acorns here and there, and then we begin to run out of space, so we start to pack them a little bit more efficient. But you know, even this has really poor performance. Another approach would be to like start in the middle, and then don't add a space, and fill the first row. Then we could begin on filling the second row, and fill the rest of the boxes basically. So now we get like 100% efficiency, which is really good. So let me ask, how many of you would consider using the first approach? Well, one at least. So I basically think that he did. So to conclude, dare to sit next to other people, hope that they don't bite you, and perhaps even talk to them and meet new friends, and everything will be a lot more fun and a lot more space efficient. Thank you.
All right. Alex, you're here. Tab, complete me later.
Okay.
Fine. This next story, folks, is set in the undersea kingdom. So it's underwater. And in the undersea kingdom, not everybody knows this, but the lobsters are like the royalty, because they're the most expensive. And so there's a lobster king and a lobster queen and a lobster princess, and they all live in this amazing aquatic castle. But then in the stratified underwater society, the most like low-class people are crabs, because you see, crabs walk sideways, so everyone thinks they're shifty, and you can't trust them. But it just so happens that the lobster princess falls in love with a crab. That's the setup of the story. Are you ready, Jackie?
Yep.
Take it away, Jackie.
All right. Hello, everyone. My name is Jyrki Pullinen, and I'm going to talk to you about a thing called manhole. And this is my Twitter handle. And you dirty people who don't speak English or who don't know the stuff behind the word manhole, it's this. It's nothing dirty. This is actually a manhole cover, if you're more concrete. The manhole is, like, that's just copy-paste on Wikipedia. It's a alternative utility hole, cable chamber manager, blah, blah, blah. Top of, is the top opening to an underground utility vault. You probably also heard about, like, this stupid interview question. So if you've ever been in a stupid interview, you've been, like, where someone asks, like, oh, why the manhole covers around? And you probably know the answer that they don't fall in, but you can actually next time, when you end up in a stupid interview, you can say to them, and pardon my French because I suck in the pronunciation, the Roland triangle can also be a manhole cover that doesn't drop in. So you can use that one next time you go into the interviews. Anyway, this all was completely useless. That's just a nice fact. I'm going to talk to you about Python manhole, which actually is a manhole into a Python process. So those who have used Twisted used to have an old manhole and they have a newer implementation, but this is for like every, like a layman Python, well, not the crazy callback Python, but the layman Python manhole. You install it by saying pip install manhole, then you import manhole and say manhole.install, or if you just run a random Python process, you give Python manhole environment variable that's just an empty string, and you run your script with that. Then what? Like, what's the point of this? Well, the manhole opens you a Unix domain socket. It runs it in a thread. There are like options that you don't need to spawn threads, but it actually runs it in a separate thread. You can connect to that Unix domain socket with the netcat, or I recommend socket with readline, and boom, it prints you out what your actual Python process is doing, like what the threads are doing at the moment. It actually gives you a traceback for each thread. You can see that there's the manhole thread on the top, or the end of the manhole thread, like a traceback, and then this other stuff. This is just running the simple HTTP server from the command line and with the Python manhole environment flag. And the best part is that at the very end, it gives you a Python interpreter. So you get the Python interpreter inside the process you're running, and then you're going to go nuts and do all kind of havoc. And why would you use this is you run, let's say you run a web service or something, so you can actually put like a long-running web service or some other long-running process. You enter manhole there. If it goes derp at some point and you don't know why, like it's running, but you don't know what it's doing because it doesn't seem to be doing anything, you can just enter the manhole and check like actual tracebacks of the stuff that it's doing there. The manhole has a decent documentation, but like actually the usage is as easy as it got. How much do I have time left?
I would say 2 minutes.
Oh, yes. because there was a PyCon Poland, I had to come back to that one. There's also a PyCon Finland. It's the 19th of October in Helsinki. Unfortunately, the call for proposals has already closed, but because they closed it in the middle of July, they're probably going to reopen it because no one does anything in Finland in July except it's on a vacation. It's an amazing conference. We used to have a tagline saying that it has more saunas than the other conferences combined. But the PyCon Poland also seems to have saunas, so I don't know. At least, same amount as other conferences combined. If you don't know, this is Helsinki. Unfortunately, in October, it can look like this. 19th of October in Helsinki. Thank you.
All right, after Alex, we've got Wukesh, maybe. For Dream About Flying? Does anyone know who that refers to? And did I get the name more or less right? Wojciech, that's, yeah, better. So the lobster princess falls in love with a lowly young crab, and they have this sort of banned relationship, but one day her father finds out, and she's like, oh, I'm not having my beautiful lobster daughter hanging around with one of those shifty, sideways-walking crabs. I won't have it. She's like, but we're in love. And she's like, no, I'm not having it. And so he, like, locks her up in the highest tower of the undersea castle, which I guess makes it the least deep underwater. The like young crab is devastated. He can't see his girlfriend. He really loved her. He's like going around all the undersea bars, like drinking away his sorrows, going, oh, I used to have this beautiful lobster girlfriend. And the weeks pass and the month pass, and the crab is sad and drinking away, and the lobster daughter is in her tower just crying, and the king feels bad, and he thinks, maybe I can cheer my daughter up, and maybe she'll feel better if we have like a big party, and maybe she'll also meet some new and eligible suitors. I mean, obviously no crabs. So I'm going to have a big ball in the undersea palace, and I'm going to invite all the respectable undersea creatures, all the tortoises and dolphins and porpoises and octopi and sea cucumbers. So they're all invited, obviously no crabs, and they have this big ball, and there's the king and the queen, and the lobster princess is sort of sitting next to the throne there, and she's just looking kind of sad, and she's not really talking to anyone. Meanwhile, the young crab is like more and more desperate than ever. Like he's all like, oh no, she's going to be married off to some awful sea cucumber. And the hours pass, and then at midnight, there's this sort of banging on the doors of the undersea hall. Bang, bang, bang. They fly open, and it's the young crab. And he looks all the way across the hall up at the king, who's like right up on his throne the other end. And he walks really slowly right down the length of the hall, 1 foot at a time, perfectly straight, 1 foot exactly in front of the other, perfectly straight until he gets up to the king and he looks him in the eye and he says, I am really drunk. Are you ready, Alex?
The live demo gods are not smiling on me. So this will be an audio-only demo.
Hooray!
Okay. So This will only work on Linux, and what I'm doing now is I'm typing ls in a directory in a directory full of Python files, and because this project uses tox, it's also full of .pyc, .pyo, and a pycache folder, and it's quite noisy. So when I type my favorite editor and I press tab, I get all those files. I don't want to see them, so what I'm going to do
we can't see
is... Yes, I know. That's why I'm giving an audio description. So what I'm doing now is I'm editing my .bashrc, and you can do the same thing in Z shell. How do you pronounce that? Anyway, what this line says is, in caps, figignore equals, and then quotes, .pyc colon .pyo .pyd and underscore pycache. I do that, I source the file, and now when I press tab, I just get my .py files and not all that .pyc rubbish.
Brilliant, I can't hear any of the other ones.
So, sorry for the lack of visuals, but try figignore. It makes the bash terminal quite, just a bit nicer place to be. Thank you.
Hooray! Yeah, those dunder pycache files are absolutely deafening. Okay. Wojciech, you're up next.
Yeah.
Really? Wojciech? Okay. I'm learning new things. All right, fine. That'll be our second last talk, everyone. And then the final talk is by Adam H. on exceptional programming. Adam, are you around? Yep, come towards the front so you can get here nice and quickly. Da-da-da-da. So where are we? Well, we had the Undersea Kingdom. Like, let's rate all the jokes now. Undersea Kingdom, like, is that your favorite? Clap if it's your favorite, the Undersea Kingdom. All right. Clap if the Extractor fan was your favorite. And clap if the Tina Turner, What's Love Got to Do with It, was your favorite. That's my favorite. Okay. But like, all right, so you guys preferred the longest one with the really bad pun at the end. So I'm just using that to like mentally, you know, whatchamacallit, calibrate what I should do for you next time. All right, yep. I think we can manage this. I know one about a man with an orange for a head. That's quite special. There you go.
I need one more second, please, because...
How did everyone enjoy the social evening yesterday? Like, clapping slightly muted there by the people who are still hungover going, well, I enjoyed it, but I regret it. I got there at about midnight, and there was no food, so all I had to eat for the first few snacks was nothing but, like, chocolate eclairs and cream cakes, and I had about six of them. And then suddenly they did bring loads more actual food out, and I felt that was a bit of a waste to have my starter be entirely cake. Oh my God, is there going to be audio in this demo as well?
There will be a live demo, I hope. So I would like to talk about my dream when I was young. My name is Wojciech Kędzierski, and I always wanted to fly. I always wanted to be a pilot. I'm not sure if this dream will be fulfilled, but I found another alternative to the ways of flying. So lately, there is this huge topic like drones, self-flying unmanned vehicles. So the plan of this talk is presented here. Basically, I think that each lightning talk should have three main threads, like getting attention, inspire, and spread awareness. In my case, I would like to get an attention by having a live demo. And yes, I will fly a quadcopter. I would like to, however, also present the fun part of flying a drone, obviously. I'm going to skip the technical lesson because we have just 5 minutes, obviously. And what's more important is the awareness about this technology. It's currently banned in Spain. You cannot fly outside because it's a danger for other people and flying vehicles.
And it's not inside?
I don't think this drone will go outside, and I don't think it's a risk for
property or other people like getting hurt. That's why I was reading this legislation, but it's difficult for me to read in Spanish, so I assume it's legal. However, I consider myself to like be to dream a lot and think about what might go wrong, and that's what I would like to present. So I'm going to fly this drone, which is not what you expect. Let's hope it will fly. It can actually flip. Here it is. So here is one part of the live demo. The real reason is that lately I've been also producing my own drone. And from my friend, I received a question when I was showing off. You know, by the way, I have created my own. I built my DIY drone. And the first question was, does it fly? So here it is, the drone I have produced on my own. So this is for my friend, dedication. I'm not sure the camera will register that, but. So that was the second part of my interactive demo. So yes, Amory, it flies. What might go wrong if you, why did I do this demo outside? So it turns out that you can really hurt somebody. If you didn't fly the drone your own, you're not aware, because obviously most of us play video games. You might think it's very easy, and it is if you already have the experience. So I'm not going to let you fly this drone, and I highly do not recommend flying it, but we can talk about this small one after this talk, and that was the purpose of this meeting. So it's really important to think about the fact that you can hurt somebody and damage a property that you wouldn't expect you can damage, like a flying vehicle or even a car driving the road. The drone can fall from the sky when the battery falls unexpectedly. So why wouldn't I fall over your heads here if I already know I can fly this drone? So I estimated the risk is not bearable, and somebody can get hurt because if it falls, and the quadcopter might get broken, but this is just a few dollars. And this is another thing I would like to like stress. This technology is getting like extremely cheap, and you wouldn't believe that this small drone I was flying at the beginning of this presentation is around 20 bucks, and you can get it, and I'm not going to advertise where and what is the brand. I will just skip it. But it's definitely affordable, and most of the people can afford it. I highly recommend it. It's a great exercise for your brain. And how does it relate to Python in this conference? So I think that I fly with Python. I work at Applause. And the reason I'm talking about Applause is that we are hiring great engineers that are not only focused on one technology, and they are not focused only on Python, but they can actually do stuff around the world. So I would like to thank you for the presentation. I'm really like happy that nothing got broken or nobody got hurt. So thank you.
All right, our last talk is from Adam.
Yeah.
An apposite pachyderm, everyone. A relephant. That way you've learned three things from that joke. The word apposite, which means in the correct place or appropriate. The word pachyderm, which means thick-skinned in Greek. Or so that includes elephants and rhinoceroses, as I. And then you've got a joke out of it as well. What do you call an apposite pachyderm? A relephant. I liked it. There you go. Da-da-da. Yeah, really long stories. Man with an orange for a head. Da-da-da. What else do we have? So it's coming up. This is the last talk. It's 6:30. Are there any announcements from the organizers? Have we got any organizers here? Anything we should know about tomorrow or anything we've got to get done? All right, I'm still wearing my beginner mentor badge, anyone? So any questions at this point?
What's with the stars?
What's with the stars? Well, the stars were from this. This is the kind of thing you pick up if you hang around the Django Girls booth for more than about 5 minutes. So they gave me a present. It was really nice. It was a goat. So I thought I'd wear the stars just to represent that. There you go. Stars and mouses. Yeah, good question. Thank you. I was happy to answer it. Uh-huh. Any others?
Yay.
There you go. Uh-huh. They're flip-flops. You know, you can't really wander around freely in flip-flops. Like, this keeps me more grounded. Definitely recommend it for talks. Like, because if you're with flip-flops, you're like, and you need to go somewhere, you know, you've got this sort of like, oh, maybe I'll trip over them slightly, and I feel uh-huh. like it's not quite right. And whereas if you've got no shoes, you like, you know everything, you're in contact with the ground, you're safe. Like, from the ground up, everything's all right. So hopefully the presentation is going to go well as well. Like, little details there. Who here read my tips for, like, who here is a speaker? Just
who knows X-Rander?
Yeah, who here is like an X-Rander contributor that would like to come and help?
X-Rander minus auto.
Huh?
5 minus auto.
No. Oh, it's great. Let's just do like this. This works. This
works pretty good. You ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Take it away.
Yeah, so in Python, we have all these very, very, very contrived things like program flow components like ifs and returns and arrays. But in C, those guys ever use return for returning an error code. So we think this is a very contrived way of doing things. So me and my colleagues sat in the sauna the other day and discussed this problem and came up with a very good solution, which we call exceptional programming. So the solution is this. We do like the C guys, but in reverse, and replace everything with exceptions. So this is obviously a very good method, because we don't return here. We don't do any sort of weirdness. We just races. And we can show this off. Right here, this obviously prints a 1. Exactly like you would expect, or not. Can also show this is obviously a very bad method where you use weirdness like returns. So let's show off what this results in. So we have not only implemented this on methods, but on comparative things as well. So obviously you don't want to use ifs if you can choose to use exceptions instead. So this is a fizz buzzer written purely in exceptional state flow.
What?
And since everyone who knows what fizz buzz is knows that this means that in the no exception error is basically equivalent to none in this case. Because if you don't raise anything, this is what will get raised. So the fizz buzz is obviously working as intended. Yeah, and this is all uploaded on GitHub. You can use it if you want to. I don't recommend it.
Oh, right. Thanks very much. So that takes us to the end of the lightning talks. Thanks very much to each and every one of you for being absolutely wonderful. I must have spoken to about 100 people at this conference. Every single one of them is amazing, lovely, wonderful people, completely different from each other in odd and weird ways. And so thank you all for being exceptional. Thank you for being here. One more day of the conference. Give yourselves a big round of applause to yourselves, all the speakers, all the organizers, everyone. Have a lovely evening. Good night. Yeah,